This is Patrick Seitz, and you are watching a Toonami Faithful podcast exclusive.
Hi.
Hello.
My name is Lonnie, and this is Christine, and we're representing Teens in Print.
Yes.
The comedic side, of course. Mm-hmm. So, did you struggle with staying in character when
I didn't struggle staying in character with them only because I never had to do them like back to back.
In general?
No, not really. I mean, there have been days where I've had to do multiple things that can get a little funky as far as keeping track. There were a couple days while we were doing the first batch of recording for Hitalia where I'd be doing Jeremy in the morning and then do Agni from Black Butler in the afternoon and then maybe do a little more Germany after that in the evening that same day. So that would get a little funky. But okay, let me hear the German accent. Okay, cool. Record. Go to lunch. Okay, now we're doing Black Butler. Okay, Agni, get him in the head. Okay, now we're going back to Germany. Wait, let me hear Germany again. Get him back in the head. For stuff like that where it's all the same day, that can get kind of funky, especially if there's an accent in play. But in general, no. I mean, whenever we go in to do a character that we've done before, they'll play a sample of what we've done before just to make sure that we are matching that same voice. So it's pretty easy to keep them straight. Welcome.
Hello, I'm CJ Mafferis, and this is Jim Nelson from Toonami Faithful, Toonami Faithful Podcast.
What's up?
Nice to meet you. I want to start off with a staple character who's been on Toonami for quite some time, Frankie.
Yes.
I'm sure you enjoy him. He's a favorite from a lot of people, so I'm curious how you feel about voicing a character. I don't know how long you've voiced him, but it seems like it's been a while, so you have to really have an affinity towards Frankie. He's one of my favorites too.
It's been a while, and actually we recorded. I mean, the first Frankie I got to do was a tiny little bit, like a couple hours for One Piece Unlimited Adventure, way back in the day on the Wii, and then we didn't catch up to Frankie in the show for another like 6 or 7 years. So there was a big hiatus between the two, and I didn't want to assume when the time came. But when it came, I'm like, hey, Mike, do I get to be Frankie again? He said yes. So, no, Frankie is, I love Frankie. I mean, he's just stupid and silly and wonderful and insightful and faithful. And no, you always love parts where they just keep chugging along. And One Piece is job security any way you look at it. But it helps that I really like Frankie. I have many Frankie figures. He's just so damn cool. Whole show.
I enjoy the catchphrases that you get to also use with Frankie.
When we first did the supers, it took a while because we're like, okay, we got to figure out what we want to do with these, because you're going to say it about a million times over the course of the rest of your life. So let's get it right. One Piece. I mean, pirates and friendship. That's really all you need in life. And food and sleep, but mostly pirates and friendship. Hierarchy of needs, food, sleep, pirates and friendship, the One Piece.
There we go.
Which is just going to be them opening up a chest, and there's going to be a mirror, and they're all going to crowd around, look in the chest, and they'll be like, oh, look, it's us and our friendship and all the things we've learned. Like, if he opens up some box and it's like some bamfast crown, I'm going to be really, really disappointed. He's like, look, it really is treasure. No, it's going to be friendship.
We had a joke that... The One Piece was the journey. That's the thing.
No, it. I mean, it can't not be. It can't not be. If it's like, look, I got this thing, and it's some really blinged out scepter, it's going to be like, well, I was 1,600 episodes. Yay, Luffy, you got your blinged out treasure?
I'm hoping it's soda.
Oh, I'm hoping it's soda, too. Really, really high-end, artisanal, locally sourced soda. Farm to table. Oh, my soda coming from a farm. No, never mind. It's going to be friendship. The One Piece is friendship. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
You really enjoy your job from what I've heard so far.
Yes.
So I'm wondering, what would you do if one morning you woke up mute?
Ah. I'd be like, I'd silently scream a couple times just to make sure that was indeed the case. If I woke up mute, I mean, I've often said if, like, one day I just suddenly couldn't do voice acting for whatever reason, I'd probably teach, like, at the college level, because I taught at high school and I want to do that again. Too much busy work. But teaching would be good, but if I couldn't talk, I'd probably just write. I'd probably be a writer. I'd probably go back doing scripts and doing some of my own stuff, because I do like writing. It'd be very hard to have, like, a real job after I've lived, like, a freelance tra-la-la man-child for the last 15 years. Like, I've forgotten how to be a person that follows directions, so probably teaching and writing. Hopefully that day won't come, though. Or if it does, at least have it be a choice. Not that I woke up in a mute. That's frankly terrifying.
Catch this and you get disability.
Yeah, I'd rather voice. If I can pick. That's a good question.
A show that Jim and I and many of the Toonami Faithful podcast hosts have heard a lot. They really want JoJo's Bizarre Adventure on the action block. They want it on Toonami. I cannot tell you enough how many people love your rendition of Dio. It's very refreshing. It was very interesting. You do a very good job. How did you get prepared for someone who's just evil for the sake of evil and not like any backstory? He's just pure evil kind of thing.
Dio's fun. Dio's a lot of fun. I had also the sort of added bonus with Dio that I got to write a lot of my own dialogue and I got to direct myself. It just worked out that way. I adapted some of the episodes for part one. They just happened to be the stuff he was in. And then once we'd established the character a couple times, the director was busy, so it was like, just direct yourself, you know the character, do the thing. So that was nice and freeing. I mean, it's like playing Iago. Like, yes, he has a beef, kind of. Technically, you know, this random Moorish guy got the job and I didn't. But he's basically just a dick. And he just rolls with that. And even at the end of the play, when he's like, I'm not saying anything. Figure it out. Torture me. I'm done. Mic drop. Evil. It's nice. I mean, it's nice to do shows where it's subtle and nuanced and whatnot. But then every now and then you just want to do a show like JoJo where you can just swing for the fences.
Did you pose as you were filling in the voice for him?
If I had, I would have never been able to leave that pose. I'd be sitting like that right now. I am not limber and I am not thin. Those poses would lead to my death. I ain't doing it. Although I did find a sweet Dio figure today in the dealer hall. So I let the figures do the bending for me. I get attached to a lot of them, really. I mean, if it's a character that I get to voice, like, over an amount of time, if you go in and you do a character just, like, the one time, couple hours, boom, you're done, it's hard to have that sort of connection. But, you know, Frankie from One Piece is definitely one of those. You know, Garrosh from World of Warcraft, Artanis from StarCraft, Grimmer from Monster. I mean, there are a bunch of characters of mine where if they're like, oh, yeah, we're going to get somebody else to do it, I'd be like, no, you're not. Because you do, you get, I don't want to say territorial, but you do get attached. Because if you're going to voice a character and have it be believable, you have to like things about them. Even if they're bad people, you have to empathize with them or admire them or like them. And you're always going to find something about them that you can. Because no one walks around in life thinking, I'm a horrible jackass. I mean, they might think, I do bad things, but I've got good reasons for it. Or like, I'm a good person in other ways. So even with villains, you have to find those things that you like about them or admire about them, or else you're not going to be real when you portray them. So most of my characters, I'm like, oh, they're mine. I like them. They're like this. Yeah, that's a good question. I like.
So there was a question that came up in a panel earlier about for many industry veterans that we've had today, Monica Rial, Carrie Karenin, and now you, for you, how has the industry changed in the 15 or so years that you have been a voice actor from your point of view?
Things happen faster. I mean, I remember working on Girls Bravo, I couldn't watch the whole show before I directed it. Like, here are the four episodes that we have from Japan, so we'll work on these, then we'll move on to the next four, and we'll figure it out. Or working on Monster, that kind of came together last minute. I had to go online and find fan subs, because I knew it was the kind of show where I need to watch this whole thing and see what happens. I can't have any surprises during, you know, the recording process where this character from over here that was not significant and suddenly, you know, the villain of the whole thing. Although with simuldubs, it is sort of going back to that same thing of, here are the episodes you can watch right now. You can't watch the rest of it, but not because Japan won't send it, but because it doesn't exist yet. So it's funny that in this sort of, you know, inexorable march towards progress, you end up with some of the same problems you had before, just for different reasons on the, you know, on the Japan side of things. Faster. I think in LA especially, it's tougher to get in because there's not as much anime as there was at one point, so a lot of times they're going to go with ringers just because there's not the money or the time, which are the same thing, to take a chance. But then you also have some studios that really are sort of encouraging and getting that new batch in, so I guess there are still openings and entries for people to get in. I feel like the clients have gotten a lot more open to the idea of shows being adapted such that you're still honoring the original source material, but maybe you aren't as slavishly devoted to the straight-up translation. You know what I mean? I feel like examples have been put out there of, like, we're honoring the thing, but we are adapting it for an English-speaking audience and doing it successfully. I feel like companies overall are a little less gun-shy about that than maybe they were a decade and a half ago. It's just weird that I've been doing this for 15 years. I start thinking about that, I'm like, 15 years? What? I mean, granted, I wasn't as busy, you know, in the first couple of years as I am now. It hasn't been 15 straight years of, like, this level of work. But it's been a minute. It's definitely been a minute. I think another change is a lot more cross-pollinization between LA and Texas than there was 15 years ago, which I think is to everybody's benefit because it keeps the casting fresh. You know, you can mix it up a little bit. Good question.
I wanted to ask about Kill la Kill. Yes. Since when I first was watching the dub for the first time, I didn't know really much about anything about it. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden we hear your voice just screaming in the classroom as the disciplinary committee. I have a feeling after we were interviewing Carrie earlier, that seemed to be a really fun project to work on. Like, how was it like working with everyone, whether it be through the voicing, whether it be the writing and all that kind of stuff, like through your eyes?
It was that's one of those projects where that first scene of him coming in and being gigantic and then chasing, you know, free falling down the stairwell to catch the dude, I knew right away, I'm like, oh, it's going to be that kind of show. Okay, no surprises here. I mean, Alex Von David directed that one, and I love working with Alex because he wants it to be good. He wants it to be really good. He's not going to settle for it not being good. But he's also open. I mean, he's got something he wants. He's got a goal in mind for the scene or the line. But then if you're like, hey, man, can I try such and such? He's like, yeah, give it a whirl. And maybe you try it and he likes it. Maybe you try it and then you and he are both like, yeah, that sucked. Never mind. Let's do it the other way. But he's open to that level of collaboration, which is cool. Because you don't want to feel like you're just someone's marionette, you know, just doing their reads all the time. Vocally, that show was tough because he just screams all the time. But I knew it going in, and I told him after that first session, I'm like, hey, let's only do 2-hour sessions for this because he's going to be screaming nonstop, so let's not blow out my voice.
I've seen the blooper reel where you run out of your voice, at least during one of the episodes. Yeah. I'm sure that happened a lot.
Yeah. Although at the 2-hour level, at least you're good for the 2 hours and you haven't totally destroyed yourself. I mean, with something like it, you have to schedule strategically to make sure it's not like, okay, I'm going to do Kill la Kill, and then right after it, do something else. Like, no, never. Do Kill la Kill the last thing that day. Try not to do anything the next morning. And it's great. Like, I love having that niche of, like, the loud, screamy guys, because not everyone can do it. But there is a price to pay. You know, it's not like walking out of a session as, like, the 15-year-old hero being like, I feel so fresh and young. It's like, okay, guys, thanks. See you next time. Bye. Yeah, no, Kill la Kill was a lot of fun. And I'm glad at the end of it they just decided not to draw the naughty bits. So I was like, there's no way they're going to be able to like put like a strategically placed potted plant or a ribbon or flying bird or a cloud over everything. It was like, we're just not going to draw them. Everybody's naked. End of the show. There you go.
It still made it on Toonami. So
it did. It did. So it did something right. Nice. I don't, it's not so much that I encounter people who are like, voice acting, what's that? As me going to cons and people be like, I didn't like you in that one show. I'm like, thanks. I'm glad we were able to clear the air over that one. I had a panel a couple years back at Anime Los Angeles. In Los Angeles, surprisingly enough. It was like a Sunday morning panel. I had three people show up because it was Sunday morning. I mean, everyone was either asleep or hungover or just done. And we're talking about Monster, the show I directed I really liked, and the guy was like, oh, you're the one that ruined the dub. And he wasn't saying it to like, he wasn't trying to zing me or get points. I could just tell as he said it and I looked at him, he just did not get that that was maybe not the thing to say. There was no like, oh, gotcha. He was just like, oh, you're the one that did it. I'm like, yes, that was me. So, I live in this weird little world of, like, actors and directors and, like, artsy-fartsy people that don't have, like, real jobs or healthcare. So I don't really encounter a lot of people giving me grief about my job. Also, I think it probably helps that I've been doing this so long. I mean, if someone's like, that's not a real job, you're like, paying my bills for a decade and a half. So, you know. But I'm thankful for that. I mean, everyone and the people in my life that mattered to me have always been really supportive. My mom was always really supportive. Like, her whole thing was just go to college, get a degree in something, anything. Just have a backup if this whole acting thing doesn't work out. But I majored in creative writing, so that wouldn't have been much of a safety net. But for the most part, no one gives me grief. And even if they did, I'm like, I'm going to go home, play video games, and pretend to be a robot. It's a horrible answer. I'm sorry. I told them.
So, since Anime Boston is really pulling out all the stops for Your Lie in April, yes. I'm wondering, since I believe you were the ADR director for it, mm-hmm. since you did do a voice in it, but I wanted to learn more about the ADR directing part. Like, was that different for you? I know you've done it for a few other shows. I think Blaze Blue as well. You might have. So, what's that process? How is that different from when you're just preparing for the voice?
You're never off duty. When you're doing the voice, you go, you do the voice, the director tells you what to do, somebody else wrote the lines, and then you do it, and then you leave. Tra-la-la. You are a free spirit off to dance the light fantastic and have the rest of your day. When you're directing, you're never off duty. You're never off duty. At least the way, there are people that direct where the day is done and they can turn it off, and I envy those people because I can't. As long as a project is going, it's always in my brain somewhere, whether I'm actively working on it, it's at the forefront of my mind, or it's the weekend or the evening, and it's the back of my mind somewhere. I didn't always know that about myself. But then I was working on Monster, and when that finally wrapped up, and I felt it turn off, I was like, oh, crap, that's been on this whole time. It's like when the TV is on, but you're not watching anything, so the screen is black, but you can just kind of hear that subtle, high-pitched sound of it, you know, physically being on, and then you don't even know it's there until you turn it off, and you're like, oh, that's what silence sounds like. That's what it's like when I'm directing, because there's always something to do. Something needs to get recorded. You need to record pickups. These scripts aren't done. This person needs to be cast. I should have done that different. I should have done this different. I should have done that different. And also the same thing when I watch a thing I've worked on. There are moments that I really like, but a lot of it's just me going like, what did I, ooh, I should have, and that's just whether it's something I've directed or something I've written or something I've voiced. I'm just in that mode where I would just want to judge and grade and nitpick. Your Lie in April was all of that plus a lot more crying because I was also doing the script. So I'm writing everyone's lines and crying while I'm doing that. And then we're actually directing the sessions and crying as people are saying the lines there. And then later we're watching it back and crying then. And adjusting things with the mix, and then doing the pickups and crying again. It was just like 8 or 9 months of tears. Near the end of the process,
I had to write the last three episodes of the show over a 4-day period, which is not usually three episodes would be 3 weeks. This was three episodes in 4 days. And it was just me waking up in the morning and sitting down at my computer and writing and sobbing and writing and sobbing and writing and then eating and going to bed and waking up and doing that again for a couple days. It was horrible. But the stuff that we got worked out, like later when we recorded it and heard it all back, we're like, okay, it doesn't sound like I was self-destructing. Like, it worked. Because that's not a show you can half-ass. You can't hold that show at arm's length at a healthy distance and be like, I'm going to give it everything it needs emotionally to make sure it doesn't, like, splash onto me. It's like frying bacon naked. Like, you're going to get burned by the grease. It was a weird analogy. But not inaccurate, I don't think. Frying bacon naked. The Your Lie in April story. Yes.
So Your Lie in April equals bacon. I'm sold. Where do I get it?
Okay, we're going to do the last round of questions very quickly, please. So, as an entertaining teenager, I discovered anime from early childhood, watching it with my dad, and it's become a real important part of me, and part of my daily routine, honestly. And whenever I mention it, people peg me as childish. As immature, and what do you have to say about people who think people that like anime are childish or children, that anime is for children and shouldn't, like, do you think it's actually for all ages?
I mean there are certainly some shows that are more geared towards kids or teenagers or adults, just depending on sort of the theme or the art style or what have you. But I think as a medium across the board, yeah, anime is for everybody. It's for young people. It's for old people. I never understand why people crap on other folks who found something they like. Like, it's that whole age thing is such a stupid thing for people to trot out. I mean, I'm going to go do the Love Live competition tomorrow. I'm a grown-ass man. I'm 38 years old. I'm going to be up there blipping and blooping my little rhythm game with my waifu idols. Like, it's silly that people put these age restrictions on. Oh, you like this? Well, you're a kid. You like that? You're a kid. Like, that doesn't make any sense because you got, like, 30-year-old men being like, I'm going to watch Steven Universe and get high. Like, you know what I mean? It's if ever there was a time where people could, I think, rightfully claim that you know, animated fare or cartoons are for everyone, it's right now. Because it really is. I mean, you've got South Park is older than the people watching anime. The show itself is older than the people who watch it. Which blows my mind, because I remember when South Park was new, and now I'm all old. I mean, sort of going back to that whole question about why the people playing WoW would give the anime fans grief, It's silly. It's people not getting it. It's people not understanding what anime is. And I get that same thing because I tell people what I do and they're like, you dub it like those old kung fu movies. I'm like, yes, exactly like those old kung fu movies. That is just what they are like. No. You know, they don't know because they haven't seen it. I mean, sometimes it's just people being jerks, but a lot of times it's people just not knowing what they're talking about. And so they make assumptions about it that aren't true. I think the important thing there is, since you're probably not going to be able to change their mind, either because they don't know or they don't care, they don't want to take the time to learn about it, just realizing, okay, they have an opinion. It's not based on anything in particular. They don't know what they're talking about, so I'm not going to let it get me down too much, which is tough. When people are talking smack about you, like, it bothers you. It bothers me when people do that. But I have to, like, remind myself, they don't know what they're talking about. They're just making sound. I'm just going to let it slide. I mean, it's really the only thing you can do about it. And then go and watch something you like. Like, too bad for them. You like all this stuff that they're never going to know about. What show do you like? Tell me a show you like.
Well, currently, you mentioned Steven Universe. I'm cosplaying Steven Universe right now.
Yeah. And people that are like, ugh, cartoons, anime, whatever, they're never going to know about it. Like, all the cool things you've seen, the characters and the storylines, they're never going to know because they're too busy being like, hur, nerds. So, sucks to be them, really. Table flap!
Hi, Mike!
I'm sorry. I had to punctuate that moment with something.
the casualty of.
Quick question for you. If you could give an elevator pitch to Toonami to get another show that either you've been a prominent voice in, mm-hmm. that you think would really do well on the block, what show would that be?
Oh, man. Hey, guys. I see you're going up to the 30th floor, as am I. Well, while I've got you here as a captive audience, maybe I'd like to talk to you about how we could maybe do like a stop motion anime, which wouldn't be anime because it's stop motion, but like maybe do something for Dune, you know, by Frank Herbert. Maybe we could do some sort of Dune series. It doesn't exist, but really cool if it did. Maybe you guys want to kick some money out into that and I could be in it. Oh, look, it's the 30th. Well, okay, bye, guys. No, do you want me to, I mean, do you want my numbers? You could, no, okay. I mean, no, find me on, okay.
They didn't like it. I don't think they're gonna call.
You tried.
I hear the young folk like podcasts. Wait, no, I'm supposed to say what you said.
Yeah.
Say it again.